When you visit MATLAB's documentation for the exponential function, then we'll explain how it actually works, just how to use it, even though for other functions like f0, they do give reference for the algorithms behind it. This video will be all about how exp actually works. First, we need to talk about Euler's number, and how you actually compute it using this summation to be about 2.718. How does this work in the computer? And the short answer is, it doesn't. Most of the time, you defined e, for example, in math.h, to be these numbers. And then, for computing the exponential function, you could write your own attempt at this. For example, here's one version using the power function and the predefined value of e. But how does the power function actually work? On first glance, you might think the power function actually just does a lot of looping if y is a natural number. And then if it was a floating point number, using properties of exponentials, you might split it up and use something like Newton's method on the fractional part. And if it was a negative number, then you just do 1 over the exponent. Or you could use logs, and that's what power function actually does. If you look into the source code for power, you'll see that the first thing it actually does is let x be to the n times some number, and then use logs, dividing up that x value, eventually computing this y prime value, and then plugging everything in to give you the actual exponent. The crazy thing is, though, notice that reference to the exponential function, and this is inside a power, which would mean you'd have exponential calling power and power calling exponential. Now, that isn't actually what happens. It recomputes the exponential inside of it. But let's talk about how to actually do that. E to the x is usually defined as this summation. And in the computer, this can cause some issues because, one, it's a lot of looping, and it can lead to things like overflow and underflow when all these terms get very large. There's also issues with roundoff error by doing division. So we can approximate things. If we graph our e to the x function, we can actually divide it into two separate functions. This one on the left is when x is negative, and we can make a very good approximation for this half of the function. That's because for negative numbers, all of our answers are going to be between 0 and 1. And we can approximate this using a very good polynomial, and Cecil Hastings Jr. made one in 1955 that worked really well. Published an approximation for digital computers, it looks like this, where all of our a terms are given in this table. And this is just a polynomial that you just plug and chug. Here's the actual reference if you're curious. In the Mathematical Function Computation Handbook, yes, there's a Mathematical Function Computation Handbook, the author explains that things have improved since Hastings using a really crazy rational polynomial. This is what the math looks like, and I know it's a lot, but if we actually dig into the source code, they break it down for us. In our comments for the exponential function, they write that the first thing you'll actually do is break up our x value into k and r values, where r is some special number using natural log of 2. Our next step is to use this crazy function approximation using what's known as a Riemann's algorithm. And if you're interested, I can make a video just on how those algorithms work. Then, after you've applied all our polynomial coefficients, and those are actually given later in the source code, you can compute a value for exp of some variable r. Then, plug that in to actually give us our exp of x. To make a long story short, what we're really doing is finding exp of g, or in this case of our code, exp of r, and computing that very accurately as 1 plus some small error correction. Using that expression. Then, using what we know about base 2, we can plug our exp of r against that and compute our exp of x, the number that we were originally looking for. Changing gears slightly, what if you wanted just a very good value for e? Given that it's an irrational number, it's a lot of terms that you'll need to add up to get a really high precision. Each of these also can overflow when you have large values for k, and then part of that division can cause roundoff or truncation error, and essentially also adding very small numbers, which can also cause errors. In 1995, Robinets and Wagon published an algorithm known as e-spigot, which is very short, firstly creating an array of ones for the number of digits that you want, and then essentially multiplying by 10 and doing integer division and modulus, moving quotients over to give you one digit at a time. Here's their original paper, and actually it's originally intended to be an algorithm for finding pi. They just sort of give the algorithm for finding e as a precursor to the pi finding algorithm. And if you're curious, I have some source code that will actually show you how to do this. Here are the first 10,000 digits of e, which actually didn't take very long to compute on my own laptop. The great thing about e-spigot is that it only requires some integer division and modulus, and none of our terms actually ever get very large. There's also no need for factorials or doing very large divisions or having this giant summation. And you can also compute it to any desired precision. All you need to do is just make your array larger. You might be wondering why this algorithm actually works, and the authors give a proof, which is rigorous but not intuitive. For a more straightforward understanding, our equation is rewritten so that we can generate just one digit at a time. There is one drawback with this kind of algorithm in that you may not be able to trust those last few digits, so the authors recommend adding about 6 or so digits at the start. For our exponential function, we don't have something like e spigot, but if you could hypothetically eliminate error entirely and just assume x was a very large number, how many terms would it take for this summation to reach about 99% accuracy? Answer that. Friend of the channel Mathemaniac has published his own video all about answering just this problem, which I definitely recommend checking out. When we first started discussing this problem, most of the documentation out there doesn't explain how the algorithms behind EXP work, but hopefully after this you have some understanding, also some understanding of how the power function actually works, which is very much related, and that Hastings published a polynomial approximation to EXP when x was negative. More modern versions of EXP use a Remes algorithm to approximate some intermediate value, and then apply this expression to compute our EXP x. Also, keep in mind we went over how the Rabinitz and Wagon algorithm works. As always, thank you for watching. In the description box, I'll leave a link to the GitHub repo for this channel where you can find the code for the e-spigot algorithm. Also, don't forget to check out Mathemaniac's video, where I'll put an end card here. And I'll also leave a card to my video on how to compute pi using machine-like formula.